So, M1 is the hot right now. Everyone can't help but praise how godlike this chip is, but is it really that good? I decided to compare it against my 2015 MacBook Pro, and let me just actually show you. Now, before we get started, I just want to preface. This is not for extreme professionals that are like editing Marvel movies and coding the next TikTok. It's just for average people and students that want a good, reliable computer. So first up, we're going to look at opening applications and doing the day-to-day operations like web searching, watching videos, all that kind of stuff. It's important to mention that the base model M1 iMac as well as the MacBook Pro both have 8 GB of RAM. That said, M1 is more snappy when loading pages and opening applications. Now, notice how I said snappy and not faster. That's because even the 2015 MacBook Pro is by no means slow, and honestly, if you don't have them side by side, you'll probably not notice it. That said, because I do have them side by side, you can definitely see the difference, especially when it's not Apple's own application. Next up are CPU intensive tasks, and for this, I am going to be using video editing, but very simplistic videos, not more complicated than my high school video. So the reason that we're using video editing as a benchmark is because this is generally something that requires a powerful CPU. Now, I use Final Cut Pro, and when using it in the M1 iMac as well as the MacBook Pro, I honestly could not tell a difference because they both ran extremely smoothly. I could easily scrub through the timeline, play and pause clips. Honestly, Final Cut Pro is so optimized that M1 didn't really make a difference there. The only two places that I really saw the M1 difference was in effects and render times. The M1 chip was able to load in effects such as video stabilization just a bit faster than the Pro, but when it came to rendering, it completely beat it. But then again, we're not talking beating it by hours. It was really just extra minutes. And for me in YouTube, I honestly use that time to, you know, fix up the thumbnail, optimize the SEO, things like that. So for me, it's not a big deal, but I know I'm not everybody, so I will give this to M1. The next test is GPU intensive tasks like video games. And in this category, they're both half decent. Apple computers were never really intended for gamers, but it does give a good idea of how strong the GPU is. And in League of Legends, I got very similar FPS with the Pro sometimes beating the iMac, so that says a lot. Granted, the fan on the Pro was just blazing and the iMac was pretty much silent. Okay, so if M1 is better than a 6-year-old computer only marginally, then what really are the benefits? First of all, has got to be that snappiness. Everything on M1 does have, you know, that sense of lowered waiting time. Almost next to nothing. And over time, yes, this does add up and overall makes the iMac feel way faster. But honestly, in real world application, I don't think it's as crazy as the benchmark numbers make it seem to be. And that's probably because Apple has already done such a good job optimizing their older machines. Nevertheless, the increased snappiness is there for sure. Next up is hardware. Now, I know it's a little bit unfair to compare the two because they are different product categories, but in terms of what is affected by M1, things get interesting. First of all, with M1, there is very, very little heat or fan activity. Now, this is amazing for staying focused while editing and, you know, not disrupting my online classes or anything like that. And honestly, it's probably healthier for the computer long term. But that does come at a price, and the M1 simply can't handle a lot of ports. You know, I'm used to having an SD card, an SSD, and a USB microphone all plugged in at the same time. And yes, you could say that Apple made this choice specifically because their past computers didn't have these quote-unquote legacy ports, but they didn't even include 4 USB-C ports on the fully spec'd M1 MacBook Pro. And the last one did, so that only means that it's a limitation of the M1 chip. And if I'm wrong, please let me know in the comments, but ports are kind of important, and if the M1 can't even handle, you know, some extra USB-C ports, that's saying something. And last but not least, longevity. Apple is going to be moving forward with M1 chips and not Intel chips, which means eventually they're gonna bite the dust. No matter how much of a good steal or deal you find online, M1 is straight up gonna have a longer lifetime as Apple continues to discontinue the old Intel chips. So okay, after looking at all of this, what is my point? I don't hate M1. In fact, I actually really like it. I've just noticed that everyone is praising M1 for good and valid reason. It's a huge leap forward and bringing professional level computing down to a somewhat affordable price range. But unless you want to build out a Mac Mini, you're not going to be finding M1 power for under $1,000, at least not yet. And I think that people that can't afford M1 for whatever reason, they shouldn't just automatically assume that their computers are garbage or outdated because of this new amazing technology. Because honestly, a computer from 2015 is stacking up just fine in most categories. In fact, check out this video where I talk about the apps that are on my MacBook Pro that work without issue, because they'll definitely help you out. And you can help me out by subscribing. Thanks for watching.